If, for example, we are looking at the potentially interested in a career of location manager, someone who is a film student now, what would be your advice of the journey looking at your experience back many years ago when you just started and now coming to the huge productions you're working on? So, what was this journey? What were the stages? And what can a young person who's interested in this job, what can they do to go in that direction?
Well, the good news is I think it might be different and better now than when I started. I did English literature at university in Leeds, and in the last summer, I suppose because I did English literature, I had two exams and then I was finished. So I was up in Leeds sort of bouncing around whilst all my housemates were doing boring stuff like economics exams and stuff like that. So I had nothing to do whilst they were kind of during the exam season. And by pure chance, I went to the Leeds Library and read a magazine, which doesn't exist now, I don't think. It's called the London Magazine. And I flicked through it, and there was an article about an organization called the London Film Commission, which is now called Film London. And they were looking for people to do work experience. So I emailed them and on emailed, maybe. I'm not that old. But yeah, no, I think it was an email. Maybe I called them. I sent them a fax. And then when I left university that summer, I went and worked there for quite a long time for not much money, or maybe no money. I had no family or no contacts in the film industry, which the film industry has hopefully slightly changed, but it's still fairly familial with a small and big F. People are still, a mate of a friend or a son of a, like there's still a bit of that, unfortunately. But that's because it's a lot based on trust, and I suppose you trust your kids to be the next, there's that. But I didn't have any connections at all. I just thought I really wanted to be a filmmaker, or be a part of filming in any way, I suppose. So I went to work at the London Film Commission in their location library. And that was all large A3, or maybe even bigger than A3, books of photos that, had been accumulated by different productions. And I became a kind of, I was born in London, but I kind of became an expert on London and met people as they came in. And then a few years after that, thought, okay, I can probably go freelance and contact some of the people that I'd met and told them that I was now available. So my process was slightly different. I didn't know anyone. I just knew I could get into it. And I suppose what I did then was work for free because I took the chance. I don't think I could work for free now because life is more expensive for everyone. And I think now it's slightly more. So certainly for locations, there's schemes that you can now join, nationally. There's kind of workshops that you can join. There's obviously Facebook groups. There's a completely different way now to connect with people and the industry. So I don't think it's I'm sure, speaking to a student, they probably think it feels impossible. But I don't think it is impossible, because you just have to want to be there. And if you're any good, you'll be recognized. And if you're any good, you'll be on the next job that that person goes on to. And that's kind of what happened to me. I went freelance, didn't know what I was doing. And then my first job was sticking photos on boards for Tomb Raider with Angelina Jolie, for not much money. But that got me into that group of location people that then went on to another film, and then I worked with them, and then you gradually move along. And in some ways, that part is always the same. You get in somehow, either if you're a BFI scheme, or there's location manager guild schemes. There's all kinds of different kind of better versions of my entrance into the industry now. There's a much more, if you're interested, there's a structure and a network of people you can get in contact, which didn't exist. And in fact, I've got a very funny story, and he's dead now, so it doesn't matter. But when I was at university, it seemed bizarre now, because we did have the internet, but it was like, It wasn't, you couldn't find everyone, in the late 90s. But I remember finding a list of producers that I sent letters to saying, I'm just about to graduate. I'd love to work with you. So some of them never replied. Some of them sent me fantastic letters back, and I might still have them saying, keep trying, you'll get in somehow. And so it kind of, it was good. The best one I got was a postcard from Michael Winner. And it was a small postcard. Now, I hope I have this, but it was a small postcard. On one side was my address in Leeds, I think it was. And on the other side was pre-printed, one side pre-printed saying, I am not currently looking for unsolicited scripts. And on the other side, it said, I am not currently looking for any production staff. And he scribbled out one and left the other side. And that's what I got back from Michael Winner. Kind of sums him up, I suppose. But what I liked about it was economic and efficient. And it also showed you he get those, that he in particular, but everyone gets a lot of letters and now gets a lot of emails and a lot of people. But the difference is if you just keep at it, keep pushing, make your own films, great. But also, as we were saying earlier, realize without giving away your passion, realize that there's, 100 jobs in the film industry that need filling and are fulfilling to do. Locations is one of them, production runners, second ADs, designers, art directors, draftsmen on in art departments, prop builders, special effects, visual effects, creatures, costumes, makeup, hair. There's so many amazing little jobs that may not feel like you're Steven Spielberg, but contribute massively to small films, TV, massive films. And without those people, the whole isn't complete, So a director cannot make a film of you can make a film on your own, but you can't make a film of any scope without a lot of help, So the team, sometimes it doesn't work, even on big films. The team can be dysfunctional. It is a big dysfunctional family. Why would you give $200 million to creative people in any other industry? You may as well take your 200 million and throw it out the window, because why would you give your money to creative people? But that's what the film industry does every day. So it's very dysfunctional and crazy. But yeah, I think it's valuable to know that there's all these kind of strange little jobs that become incredibly important and specialized, and without which movies do not start filming at 7 o'clock in the morning without that person. So, I'm a bad example in a way, as I obviously want to be a director and want to be a writer. I've managed to do that, but also I've then carved out a kind of a career doing my day job. So I'm in a way I'm a weird example, because I'd drop the location work in a heartbeat if I got the other job. But anyway, but I'm keeping, I've got to pay the rent, obviously. But so that's I people want to be in the film industry because of what they believe will be glamour, and it's definitely not glamorous. It's very long hours, and it's quite a commitment, in terms of your personal energy and life. It's long. You go away for a long time. I'm away now. Last year I was away for 8 months out of the year. So it's kind of hard on families, and like it's not, it's a quite a dysfunctional industry, but it's exciting and strange, and there's lots of weird people, and some people find their home there. Some people don't, and that's fine, because not everyone wants to do, fits in eventually, because some people want a life. And those people, it's got better, because I think life, work life balance is being addressed a lot more in the last 10 years, but also frequently now from since COVID. Everyone's sort of trying to balance that a bit. The film industry claimed to do it during and after COVID. I think it's fallen back into its own ways, but yeah, it's a very odd, exotic, but without glamorizing it. It's a kind of strange industry. So, you know,
So you
I'm in
wouldn't
the jungle.
recommend it to students to go
I
to
would,
see.
if they if they're committed to it and they're, you know, they're switched on to it, they got to go for it and see whether they like it. But the reality is, you know, it's long hours,
Hard
hard
job.
work, kind of, you know, tough at times, but also ridiculously stupid at times. You know, you're in the jungle on a boat traveling up the jungle, taking photographs of, you know, caves, and then you think, what is this really a job? You know, I was trying to fix my internet on the phone to someone in the UK 2 days ago, and he was a lovely guy, and he said, what's because I couldn't get on the internet or something, I couldn't get my email, and he said, would you mind me asking what your job is? And I said, well, I'm sort of a location scout. And I told him where I was, and he was like, does that job exist? And I was like, yeah, it does, unfortunately, and I do it. And he was just, yeah, he was kind of amazed that a job like that existed. So a kind of a professional, a paid gap year student is how I see myself most of the year. I never had a gap year when I left university. I went straight into the film commission and worked. So I feel like I'm getting my gap year, but every day. So
Nice.
that doesn't sound too bad, does it? I'm a sort of paid backpacker, a backpacker that flies business class. So,
Can you give us a little
so
bit
I'm
of
making
context?
it now. I'm making it sound now. I'm making it sound glamorous, aren't I? See, that's the thing.
Let's make it sound even more glamorous. Can you give us
Yeah.
an example of what of the films which you're working on was the most interesting and creative and had some amazing time, which you remember and have lots of stories to tell about? Maybe don't tell us all the stories, but kind of tell in general what which production was the most exciting.
I mean, so I suppose I'm my life so far is split in two. It was definitely London and the UK, and then about 10 years ago, I got a call from a designer to say, "Would you like to come out to Malaysia, and work with Michael Mann?" And I was like, "Yeah, that sounds pretty amazing." And I'd never gone abroad, and I knew location people do go abroad, and I thought, wow, why can't I get that gig? Because that's where it really gets interesting, you know. And I was kind of getting, I was a little bit like proving Samuel Johnson wrong. I was getting a little bit tired of London, and tired of life. So I thought, why can't I get this gig? And then out of the blue, it came, and my daughter was 3 months old, and I was like, okay, let's go. So it was only meant to be for a couple of weeks in Malaysia, working for Michael Mann, who's a huge fan of. So I thought, this is going to be fantastic. And I came back 22 weeks later, having gone to Jakarta, Hong Kong, all over Malaysia. And then so I was still on the film as we wrapped, and I went to the wrap party. So that was my intro to the new dawn of my location scouting career, which was going international, which then everything's crazy because you're just turning up somewhere, meeting someone, getting in a car or a van or on a bike, and then going off into the unknown. So it kind of reinvigorated the whole job. So that film was great fun. I was in helicopters all day and on speedboats. I was pretty much in a Michael Mann film, making a Michael Mann film. And so that was a great intro. And then beyond that, then I started to do Star Wars films, which were great fun. And Star Wars films and that kind of style of film is kind of very open in the sense, you know, you're looking for, we're stuck on planet Earth, but we're looking for different planets. So it kind of, it shows you how amazing planet Earth is that you can kind of create these exotic places, but actually they exist and you can go there. So jungles, deserts, ice, you know, all of that kind of stuff. And then, yeah, so my first Star Wars film was Rogue One, and I traveled to Vietnam, Thailand, and we were looking for a tropical beach for the end of the film. Oh, I went to Mexico for a month, which was great. And then we were looking for a tropical beach, and I got sent to the Maldives to scout for a tropical beach, and found one. It's not that difficult. And then I spent 10 weeks in the Maldives working with the location manager setting up the shoot, because I selflessly thought I should look after the location as well as scout it, because I didn't want anyone else to go to the Maldives. So that's a bizarre example of bringing a giant science fiction film with, you know, movie stars and stormtroopers and, you know, crazy amounts of equipment to virtually uninhabited islands. I mean, the main place we shot was two uninhabited islands in the Indian Ocean, which we had to get 40 boats to get everyone there every morning. People walking up to their neck in water to get onto set, and pure crazy. If you were doing a small film about a tropical island, you probably wouldn't even do that. But to bring 200 people, 40 boats, a helicopter and a container that we then remade in the Maldives so we could do helicopter footage, stormtroopers played by the Maldivian army. So that's always my benchmark of complete craziness, was the end of Rogue One, filming Star Wars on an abandoned, you know, a derelict islands in the middle of the ocean with nothing on them. And we would pop up in the morning, put a small toilet, the caterers would set up, and then all of a sudden 200 crew would turn up on dinghies, kayaks, speedboats, everything you could imagine. And we kind of called it D-Day in the morning and Dunkirk in the evening, without being flippant about all of the reality of that. But it was quite an operation. So that's a bizarre example of a massive film taking a massive chance on a very remote, strange, beautiful place that obviously then becomes another planet in the movie and becomes iconic in that film. And, you know, and of course, as we're talking about Kubrick by candlelight, the reality of all that filming was, you know, crazy. People, you know, falling into the water and life jackets just blowing out because someone flicked water on them, and all kinds of, you know, lots of other stuff that I can't tell you about. But then in the movie, you know, it's becomes a fantastic planet that then people make Lego toys out of. And I started doing Star Wars films, which means you can kind of push the envelope, because what you're looking for is the most bizarre, stunning natural landscapes in the world, basically. And most of the time you can go to those places on their money. So on Star Wars, for the two or three Star Wars I've done, I've been to Hawaii, Laos, Vietnam, Thailand, the Maldives, Morocco, Italy, never South America, which is still not on my map, which is a shame, but hopefully soon. Loads of Malaysia, all over the world. Now, not all of it makes the movies, but that's part of the process of finding what's the best looking, and then also then finding what's logistically possible, financially possible, what country has a tax incentive. Again, as I said, even of my movie compared to Star Wars, they're always looking for a dollar, you know, like, so a tax incentive in a country is an incentive, because that's money back. And that's why Star Wars was filmed in the UK anyway, because there's a tax incentive. And so it's all brutally about money, as we know. It's show business, I suppose. But ultimately then the place has to be, you know, a good looking location, basically. But yeah, so I've worked with Michael Mann a few times now, and yeah, done some Star Wars films, and sounds quite flippant, but you know, they're all increasingly exciting, and every time I get to go to a new country is kind of like a complete bonus in life, really, to kind of turn up somewhere like where I am now, which I can't tell you about, but turn up and figure it out, you know. Like I was in London in some ways, you know, like it's just the same concept, but you're in a completely different country with some language and then someone helping you or someone, a driver, and turn down this road and then see what happens down that road. So it's this bit is great fun. Now, what will happen eventually when you choose somewhere is all of the other stuff, you know. It's the same all over the world. Contracts and governments and local governments and police, and where's everyone going to go to the toilet and where's everyone going to eat, and all of the kind of crazy stuff that sounds boring, but actually the whole carnival has to turn up and have breakfast, and how do they do that? And the Maldives, there's a great example. That was all boats. There was no vehicles. It had to be all boats. And then the Meg 2 last year in Thailand was, you know, hundreds of people. We had to build almost a town for people to film on a beach, and every job has, you know, its kind of challenge basically, but beyond my bit, which is the scouting. But sometimes luckily I get to do the next bit, which is where it gets into planning and production and, you know, managing people and managing governments and all of that kind of sort of. I suppose that could be the boring stuff, but it kind of then becomes a different challenge, basically. So yeah, so I you know, I've been lucky to work on some big stuff that they often have the time. Now, the time is better than the money, but they have the time because they have the money. So that I've got time to go and figure out a country, whereas most films tend not to be able to do that. But it's the time and money are kind of combined. They have a lot of the big films have a very long development phase where they kind of figure, Star Wars is a good example, like figure out planets and how they match up with the next planet that they're going to go to. So if they're going to a desert, they can't really go to another desert. So we've got to go jungle. And then what does that mean? And so it's on a very big, grand conceptual level. And I contribute to that by, you know, doing research and then going to the real place and seeing whether it works, you know, whether it looks like the Instagram picture that I've been showing them. And sometimes it doesn't. And that's part of the process of going there and going, okay, it's compromise. When you look behind you, there's a huge car park, which then for a designer is like, oh God, it's ruined. But for production, location managers, and everyone else on the film, they go, this is fantastic. So it's kind of managing all of the creative versus production problems, I suppose, which is we're kind of in between location department. We're kind of helping the creatives find the best place, and then once we found it, helping production make it work. So that's where the location department sits, basically, in between the crazy and the money.
Well, sounds very exciting. We need to start wrapping up, but I still have a little bit time, if David is okay with that, to ask some final questions from you guys.
How do you choose between working on a sound stage or going on location? Because you're not involved with sound stages then, I imagine, or are you? How does that work?
No, I mean it's unless we're finding a sound stage in a foreign country to help augment the location or provide weather cover. But yeah, so that question that happens all the way through the film in some way. So the production designer and the art director, supervising art director, work very early on if they have a script. Most of the time we have a script. Sometimes we don't, but and look through all of the scenes, and then they break each scene down, and then they talk to the director and they talk to the producers about what money they have and what the director really wants to do. Some directors say, I want to just shoot in a soundstage because it's controllable and I can work in it without, you know, real life. Or a director may say, I need to be in the real stuff because all of the bad stuff that is birds, traffic, people walking in is what I want in my film, in the sense I want a kind of energy that. So Michael Mann is a great example. He loves locations because all of his films are almost all on location. And his locations mean something to the characters. They mean something to the scenes. So to work on locations with him was a great honor because he is one of the location directors. So he would be unlikely to do a studio film. It's set inside a studio because he appreciates the quality of light, real life, background, people, the messiness, and tries to capture that, I suppose. So the decision's not necessarily to do with me or our department. I suppose what would happen is if I couldn't find something that they really wanted to do on location, then it may drift back to being a soundstage. But that's a very early, big conversation that goes back and forth. So sometimes I might find something that, you know, like on the Batman a couple of years ago, I would find a location that we originally thought we would build. And then I present them something that actually saves them a lot of money in building or time. And then that, so there's constant back and forth between those two things of, I'd love to do this on location because I can't build it. We can't afford to build this railway station, or, you know, there's some things that are naturally always going to be locations or on set. If you're doing a massive action sequence that's going to take 3 months in a train station, you better build the train station. That's great. You know what I mean? So there's a big, a long, long process that we're part of that. You know, they come to us and go, do you think we can X here? Or what would you suggest if we really wanted to do this? Or so it kind of goes back and forth until, you know, quite sometimes almost during the filming, you'll still be tossing that up between, you know, could we find this? Or, you know, and sometimes vice versa, you pull it out because the actor may be only available one day, so you better build the set so there's no chance that it goes wrong. And so it's a constant process.
Thank you, Janet. Doran, any final
questions? Yeah, well, I just wanted to ask, really, with the locations, it does seem to me sometimes that it could be quite a long process. You've got an idea of what they want, and then you've got, obviously, it takes time for you to research, go out and find it. Is that place going to be right? Because all the other aspects that you mentioned, you know, the logistics-wise, can we get, you know, it might look fantastic, but, you know, can we get a crew, et cetera, here? So, you know, and do you end up having to do, you know, several locations, you know, sort of going from one that doesn't work out, and then, you know, so how long can it sometimes take to get?
Yeah, I mean, anything can happen. You know, you can lose a location, which is the worst thing that can happen, but it can happen because there might be a royal funeral or COVID or, you know, all kinds of things hit, and then you have to roll with it and find an alternative. Or sometimes a location turns around having said yes and turns around and says no because they realize what they've got themselves into, or, you know, a million different things can happen. So I generally, if I get asked to find, you know, a pub, you would go and maybe look at 10 or 15 pubs and then show the designer and see what fits the brief and where it might be in the country or the town. And then they whittle it down into their best looking ones. And then we always then try and go and scout a few options with the designer and the director. So they're never left short just in case something goes wrong. And it will go wrong because, you know, filming isn't everyone's priority outside of filming. So you have to roll with all kinds of, you know, like the house in Miss Peregrine is, you know, we could have lost that because the guy who bought it went, no, you know, and then we would have been back to square one. So it can be a long process. Things like Star Wars and those bigger franchise films, I often start really early because I'm part of a development process in terms of ideas that get given to designers, and then they take a picture of something and then from me, and then it becomes a concept picture. And so there's a lot of that process. And then sometimes, so a good another weird example is that film I did with Michael Mann. This is the total opposite version of that. He needed a street in Malaysia that had a mosque in front of it for a scene in a car. And I scouted it about midnight, and they came and shot at the location at about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. So that's very unusual, but that's an opposite example of how loose you could be if you're that kind of director. Or you're in a country that you can be slightly looser in, but that's very rare, and you couldn't do that in the UK and most places. And certainly if you had a massive film, you couldn't be that loose. But that's a good example of either way. Sometimes it takes months of research and visits and driving all over the country or driving all over the world, or it can take 2 hours. And this is no word of a lie. When I was scouting for that street, I was in a van, and behind me were two portaloos on the back of a low loader waiting to see where we chose so they could drop off the toilets. So toilets is a kind of recurring theme in filming, as you can see. And that's true. And so I took a picture on my phone and I sent it to Michael, who was filming in an airport outside of Kuala Lumpur. And I showed him the picture of the street with the mosque in front of it. And he said, yeah, it's good. And then the toilets were dropped. And then, you know, 2 hours later, 50 little vans turned up and we shot the scene. And the scene's in the movie and they're inside a car. And you can kind of see a green blob in the background, but the green blob is a mosque. But that meant something to him because he wanted to say something about where we were and that moment. And so, yeah, that's an odd story about how loose you can be and need to be sometimes in filming. Certainly on my film, you know, you've got to be loose because you're small and you can run around and jump in a car and go and film something. Or you've got 500 people and 400 horses, and then it takes months of planning and environmental reports and, you know, governments and local governments and tourism officials and helicopters. And so there's filming is all of that all of the time.
And risk assessments, probably.
And risk assessments, endless risk assessments.
I know.
So certainly wasn't many risk assessments. Well, there were risk assessments on that Michael Mann film, but, you know, that's the great example of kind of keeping loose. If that's your style, you know, Star Wars isn't that, because you can't just rock up with 20 stormtroopers. And I mean, you can, we did. And I'll quickly tell you that example was Rogue One. Then we filmed in Canary Wharf tube station overnight. So it took weeks and months of planning, but the filming of that scene, which is in the film, we came in just as they were finishing service on a Saturday night. And then so they finished service at, you know, 11, half 11. And then we came in, and everything could be handheld and brought down escalators, filled it with stormtroopers and droids, and took away all of the London transport and underground stuff, all within about 4 or 5 hours. And then we were out before the first person turned up. Wow. To go to work the next morning. And what was going on at the same time was one of those secret society film events, which was Empire Strikes Back. And they were going to Canada Water via Canary Wharf. So we had this barrier. And on one side was real stormtroopers, real droids, Felicity and all of the actors, Diego Luna. And on the other side were people dressed as Chewie and stormtroopers. And they never knew. And if they had known, there would have probably been a riot. But that's an example of a massive film doing something very nimble. If the director, which was Gareth Edwards, who's obviously done very similar nimbleness with the creator now, of keeping it, you know, keeping it nimble, if that's what you desire, you know, and then the whole production has to fold in to that view, even though it might not feel like it, and you think it's too big. We did it, and we got in and out overnight in a tube station and turned it into a Star Wars environment. So crazy, but true, unfortunately.
That's an amazing story. That's an amazing story.
I said earlier I would tell you who scouted Morecambe. I had worked with them, but I didn't work with them on this film. But Chris Nolan scouted Morecambe Bay for Interstellar, because he was looking for a very, very fine level of water for one of his planets. And you'll see it in the film. It's that famous planet where they're just up to their ankles in water. So he went to Morecambe quite early on in the development process to look around, kind of figure out whether it worked or the concept worked of a water planet. I remembered that story.
Where did they shoot it in the end?
You know, I think it was a studio. I think it, in the sense, it's probably a very shallow tank. I think it was a studio set that then obviously was extended beyond, because that sequence then has got tidal waves and all kinds of craziness. But I remember he went to Morecambe with some friends of mine, colleagues of mine, to kind of look at it as a location, but I suppose also in that early stage figure out whether it was physically possible to do it for real or what it might look like, or, you know. But so yeah, unfortunately he didn't film in Morecambe, but he went there for inspiration, certainly.
Okay, thank you so much. We probably didn't cover even half of what you could have told us, but thank you for joining us and spending your day off in a faraway country which cannot be named to kind of talk with a tiny group of us. And thank you, Mikhail and Janet, for joining us. And I hope more people will be able to watch the recording of it later. And we really hope maybe, if you will have any break between your day job, you will be able to join us next year in Morecambe. And I don't know, can organize some workshop with you, because you definitely tell a lot about something which people might want to pursue.